Hello aspirants, this is the video lecture about discussion on polity questions of mains 2019 brought to you by AA Shah's IAS Institute. Here we are trying to give you certain pointers to answer these questions and how you should have attempted these questions. Obviously you can enhance and enrich your answers by adding your own points by using various fruitful resources. So let's discuss the paper further. So the entire polity section was of 95 marks, in which 4 questions were of 15 marks and 2 questions were of 10 marks. So you can imagine how important the polity section is for the entire GS paper number 2, right? So let's discuss the questions one by one. Yeah. So the very first question was that what can France learn from the Indian constitution's approach to secularism? Secularism. That means here you'll have to compare the secularism in France and secularism in Indian constitution. Okay. So the very first point you can talk about is the constitution of both the nations advance the principles of equality as a basic value. So the equality is same in both the nations, but the equality is also different in both the nations. How? The meaning of equality is fundamentally different in both the nations. In France, everyone is equal under the law, subject to same law, irrespective of religion. That is separation of religion and state. That means in France, there's a separation in religion and state. That means both are different. But in Indian context, it is totally different. How? In contrast, Indian secularism doesn't imply separation of religion and state, equal treatment to all religion. In India, we give equal treatment to all religion. Obviously, you know, we live in India, we have a different kind of secularism, we have equality to all religion, we respect all religion, so we have a different sort of secularism. Indian constitution's mandate is that there should be no domination of one religious community on other, no domination of same members on the other members of the same religious community, no enforcement of any particular religion by state and taking away the religious freedom from individual. So there should be no enforcement of any particular religion by state. State cannot impose any religion on its subject by taking away religious freedom from individual. That means each and every individual and each and every community has their own religious freedom. Okay, that is the freedom of expression, belief. Okay, passage of law in France banning students from wearing any conspicuous religious or political signs or symbol. So here you can see that in France they don't tolerate such kind of activities. What, which activities? That is religious and political activities which may hamper the situation. Okay, so they pass the law which banned student from wearing any kind of religious and political symbol, like burqa was banned in France, right? Culture of inter-religious tolerance in India. So here we have inter-religious tolerance. That means each and every community is entitled to have a free practice for their religion. Okay, in India, inter-community equality replacing notion of hierarchy. So in India, there is inter-community equality. Each and every community is equal under the law. Okay. So these pointers were important and they should have been in your answers if you were supposed to write the answer in a good format. Right. So yeah, let's discuss the next question. The time has come for India and Japan to bring a strong contemporary relationship, one involving global and strategic partnership that will have a great significance for Asia and the world as a whole. Comment. So here, basically, India and Japan's relationship India and Japan's current relationship has been asked and how it should go further so that it can have a great significance for Asia and the world as a whole. It has been asked, so you are supposed to comment on that. Okay, so firstly you will have to give some background about how the India and Japan's relationship has been evolved since a long period of time. So special strategic and global partnership they have made. Japan's investment in India since 1980s. You can also write about this. Japan's largest bilateral donor for India since 1958. I'm sorry about that, but Japan is the largest bilateral donor for India since 1958. So you just correct. You can just make yourself correct here. Japan is the largest bilateral donor for India since 1958. Infrastructural projects you can write about. बहुत सारे projects आए हैं. Obviously, with Japan is investing in India, like the bullet trains in Ahmedabad is one kind of such example. You can write about bilateral trade ties strengthened with SEPA, that is Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement. You can write about this. 2+2 dialogue have been proceeded at the foreign and defense secretaries level. Japan India Act is forum, that is ZICA, is also there for their strong partnership. Asia Africa growth corridor is the important one, which has recently been made into the progress. Act is policy. Free and open Indo-Pacific, India and Japan's in alignment. So these all things are very important, which are very recent one. You can add into your answers. India-Japan engagement, not just focused on economic issues, but regional security, maritime issues, energy security and UN's reforms. So India-Japan engagement are not just focused on economic issues, but they are also focused on regional security, maritime issues, energy security and UN's reform. Okay, so how they should proceed further to make a great significance for Asia and the world as a whole. Both are formulating strategic partnership to mitigate the risk and vulnerabilities arising out of current transition of power in Asia. So both are making analysis of the situation which is prevailing now, because geopolitics is changing very rapidly and very dynamically. India and Japan need investing long-term strategy to balance China's hegemonic policies. Obviously, you know that China is emerging as a big power and is trying to influence the regional real politics. So here India and Japan needs investing a long-term strategy to balance China's strategies, okay, and its policies, right? So here goes the next question, which was on what grounds a people's representative can be disqualified under the Representation of People's Act 1951. Also mention some remedies available to such person against his disqualification. Okay, so it was a very basic sitter question, you can see, which is directly from Lakshmikant Polity. So here it's just you were supposed to write about the definition and some background about the Representations of People's Act. Okay, so you just need to give some definition about or background about Representation of People's Act of 1951, and then how the members are disqualified on basis of this act. Okay, so there were the various criteria for that disqualification, which you should have written in your answers, like disqualification of conviction for certain offenses, disqualification on the grounds of corrupt practices, disqualification for dismissal of corruption of disloyalty, for corruption of disloyalty, disqualification for the government contracts, disqualification for office under government company, disqualification for failure to lodge account of election expenses, disqualification arising out of conviction and corrupt practices. Okay, so these were certain disqualification criteria which has been listed in Representation of People's Act directly into the polities, Lakshmikant's polity. The next part of the question asks you to write about the remedies available to such person against his disqualification. So remedies as such are that one can go to Supreme Court and High Court. So basically they may approach judiciary for the disqualification under the Representation of People's Act in 1951. Okay. Right. Yeah. So moving to the next question further. It was Parliament's power to amend the constitution is a limited power and it cannot be enlarged into absolute power. In the light of this statement, explain whether Parliament under 368, Article 368 of the constitution can destroy the basic structure of the constitution by amending its power. So here in the very first part of this question, you can see that this statement is directly given from the book of Polity, that is Lakshmikant. The Parliament's power to amend the constitution is a limited power and it cannot be enlarged into absolute power. So this is the very basic statement which has been given in your book, Polity's book. Okay, so you cannot deny this statement. This is true fact. So in the light of this statement, explain whether Parliament under 368 of the constitution can destroy the basic structure of the constitution by amending its power. Yes. So here you are supposed to write your answer beginning from background, that you should give certain background about that what are the articles which are there to amend the constitution. Amendment of the constitution you can write in your background or in your introduction part. Okay, and then moving further, you can write some details, peculiar details which are needed to proceed further for the reaching up to the basic structure of constitution's judgment. So you can begin from Shankari Prasad case judgment, and then you can come to Shankari Prasad judgment case. You can talk about Golaknath case judgment, and then 24th Amendment Act, and then case one and the Bharti case. Give a little bit detail, not much, but at least in one or two lines about these cases and their judgments. Okay, case one and the Bharti case in 1973, and then about 42nd Amendment Act of 1976, and finally in Minerva Mill case, Supreme Court held that constitution had conferred a limited amending power on the Parliament, and the Parliament cannot enlarge that very power into an absolute power. Okay, so in Minerva Mill case, Supreme Court clearly stated that constitution had a limited amending power. So Parliament had a limited amending power and it cannot enlarge that very limited power into an absolute power. Okay, Parliament cannot under Article 368 expand its amending power so as to acquire for itself the right to repeal or abrogate the constitution or to destroy its very basic feature. So Parliament can make some changes, but can make some changes in form of amendments, but it cannot destroy or abrogate the very basic feature. Okay, further, the same thing was emphasized in the Vaman Rao case in 1981. So these were the pointers you were supposed to write in your answers. These were the basic things which were supposed to be in your answers. Okay, so here the next question was about the reservation of seats for women in the institution of local self-government has had a limited impact on patriarchal character of the Indian political process. So basically it is asking about that what is the state of women representatives due to the patriarchal character of Indian political process. What is their impact in the local self-government, right? So you were supposed to write about some introduction part in the beginning, like how the reservation the reservation for women in the local government was through 73rd and 74th amendment of the Indian Constitution. Okay, so they got 33% of reservation in the local self-government through 73rd and 74th amendment of the Indian Constitution. Okay, that was called as democratic decentralization, which got happened in 1993, right? And then after you can write about some achievements of these after the passage of these amendment act of Indian Constitution to include women in the local self-government by providing them 33% of the reservation. So next you can write about their achievements. So what have been done and what are the state of affair as far as the seats of women in institutions of local self-government is concerned. Next you can, the crux, the main theme of the answer was challenges. What challenges they are facing, that is, elected woman representative still faces much discrimination, that is, going about her daily duties from the male relatives. So you can imagine in today's, in this modern Indian state also, there are still women who face lack of support from their families as far as their job is concerned. Okay, so it's not just about seats of women in the institutions of local self-government. Women in other fields also face some patriarchal typical typical patriarchal outrage from society. Okay, they are prevented from discharging their duties. Dalit backward caste-based discrimination is also there. Obviously, if the woman is belonging, not only just woman here you can talk about the male person also, they also face discrimination when it comes to the caste-based discrimination. Okay, so this criteria can also be added in the process. Okay, lack of support from EWR's male colleagues, that is elected woman representatives male colleague. So they lack the support from them. They don't generally intend to help them. Lack of support from administration. That is, if pursuing in any case further, they don't get support which they need from judiciary and local thanas and all. Obviously, you go through the news about this each and every day. Okay, so here are some measures which can be taken to improve this situation. To overcome such challenges, various initiatives that can be taken, example, Meri Panchayat, Meri Shakti, Mujhe Bhi Gino, this kind of initiative. It's a campaign in Jharkhand to encourage women to contest panchayat elections and to educate them on their roles and responsibilities in elected position. So this is a kind of initiative have been taken in Jharkhand to encourage women to contest panchayat elections, and not just to contest the elections, but also to educate them about their roles and their responsibilities and how they should proceed strongly. Okay, yeah, so the next question is also, you can see that it was a very direct question from Lakshmikant Polity, and the question was about Attorney General. That is, Attorney General is the chief legal advisor and lawyer of the Government of India. Discuss. So it is a very basic question. You can have a look in your Polity book and what all things he can do for the Government of India basically is asked. So it is twisted in this form, that is, Attorney General is the chief legal advisor and lawyer of the Government of India. Discuss. Okay, so firstly you need to talk about the articles that are dealing with the Attorney General of India. Okay, so Article 76 and 78 deals with the Attorney General of India. He is the highest law officer of the country. He is responsible to assist the government in all its legal matters. Okay. So he is the one who is responsible to assist the government in all its legal matters, appointed by president. So he is appointed by whom? He is appointed by president. He gives advices to the government of India upon such legal matters referred to him or assigned to him by the president. So he gives advices to the government of India on the legal matters which are referred to him or assigned to him by the president. He himself cannot take an initiative, but he should be referred the legal matters or assigned by the president to look into the matters and give advices to the government of India. Perform such other duties of a legal character that are assigned to him by the president. Also, he performs other duties of a legal character assigned to him by president. Again, president's role is very important. He discharges the functions conferred on him or under the constitution or any other law. So he discharges the functions conferred on him under the constitution or any other law. Okay. He appears on behalf of the government of India in any reference made by the president to the Supreme Court under Article 143 of the Constitution. So he appears on behalf of government of India. So in whichever court, in any reference made by the president to the Supreme Court under Article 143 of the Constitution, he appears on behalf of the government. Okay. He appears on behalf of the government of India in any case, in High Court also, in Supreme Court also, in High Court also. Okay. So in which the government of India is required. So wherever the government of India is concerned to be present in a legal matter, the Attorney General of India on behalf of the government of India is responsible to be there, to appear there. Okay. In the performance of his official duties, the Attorney General has a right of audience in all courts. So as far as the performance of Attorney General is concerned, his official duty is concerned, he has the right of audience in all courts. So he can sit in all courts. He can take participation in the proceedings also. Okay. Right. So these are the functions of Attorney General of India, basically, which was asked as the chief legal advisor and lawyer of the government of India. So basically, you are supposed to write about all these points only. Right. Okay. Moving to the next question. Yeah, so this, the last question is actually basically about the IR part, I guess. Yeah, it was about the international relations. That the question was, what introduces friction into the ties between India and US is that Washington is still unable to find for India a position in its global strategy which would satisfy India's national self-esteem and ambition. Explain with a suitable example. So the question is asking what introduces friction into the ties between India and US. So basically, the first part of the question is asking about the friction between India and the US. Okay. So what are those bone of contention issues that are bringing frictions into the India and US relationship, due to which Washington is still unable to find for India a position in its global strategy which would satisfy India's national self-esteem and ambitions, right? So here you are supposed to write about the bone of contentious issues which are bringing friction in the ties of between these two nations, and what is Washington's stand for India, and how India's national self-esteem and ambition is concerned with all these matter. Okay, so write some background about India and US relationship so far, how India and US relationship has been evolved since a long period of time. Okay, and then you can write about the India-US trade policies discord, which is the current issue going on. Okay. That is withdrawal of generalized system of preferences, which is a very current one, happened in the last year. Status for women Indian export coming into the US. Okay. Next, you can write about India, Iran, and US strife. US is sanctioning Iran, and as India being the second largest consumer of Iran's oil, obviously, sanctioning by US can hamper Iran-India relationship too. Okay. India's solar policy issues you can write about, that is the use of indigenous equipment by India. Okay, was challenged by the US in WTO. Next, you can write about the visa issues also. Stringent regulation on Indian immigrants by the US. IPR regulations. India's insistence on availability and affordability of drugs and US pharma companies has led to the reluctance of US pharma companies to invest in R&D, that is research and development. So this was also the issues. Visa issues was there. India's solar policy issue was there. In generalized system of preferences issues were there. Okay. Unilateralism and military intervention in the West Asia, that is in Afghanistan especially, by the USA has been antithetical to Indian diplomacy. So this is unilateralism and military intervention is not a new thing for US. Okay. This has been a part of US strategies and policies in the West Asia since a long period. So this is antithetical to the Indian diplomacy. So somewhere this is also hampering the Indian diplomacy, because India has a good relationship, goodwill with Afghanistan and some of the West Asian countries. Fight at WTO regarding visa issues. Trade facilitation agreements are the major issues of divergence. Here it is off. Okay. So these were the basic pointers which were supposed to be there in your answer, so that your answer should go with the question very well. Okay. Thank you.